Okay, thank you once again, Ramesh.
Yes, sir.
I thank the management of Pratibhama University for providing me this opportunity to present myself in this program, the skill development program. Dr. Ramesh had introduced myself as a professor of biotechnology, but I would like to be introduced myself as an aquarist, okay. A passionate aquarist, in fact. You see, this passion, or you can call it an obsession also, it all started during my graduation, maybe from my school days. So from that day particular onwards, you know, I felt I was in love with these animals, these organisms, the fishes, the colorful fishes, and the green plants. You know, I also had a small organization in the names of Gills and Greens. So that is how I am usually visible to everybody in this particular field. Okay, we'll get into this particular session because this is quite a very, very, very vast area to talk about. Hopefully you would have heard yesterday's speech from Dr. Deepak Samuel. He also told the same, because the diversity of ornamental fishes is a huge area that we'll have to take class for almost 2 days. In fact, if I'm going to start about aquarium fishes and plants, I'll have to almost go in for another 3-4 days. So let me brief myself to a very, very common types of fishes and plants, which definitely would have come across, and the biology of those organisms, and how well you can breed them in your vicinity or in your at home at all also. I'll also be touching a few points about the plants, very common plants which can yourself propagate it at home. Okay, first, this is a very basic question. I think I should be ashamed of asking this, because everybody would know what is an aquarium. But anyhow, since it is a forum, there would be many people who are very aware of aquarium, and there will be few people who are not aware of it. So for those people, so what is an aquarium? An aquarium is a tank or a pool. Okay, live alone bowl. So I'm not very much interested in bowl. It's a tank or a pool filled with water, where you keep live fish or any underwater organisms in that matter. So what exactly we do in an aquarium? We are going to mimic the environment. So these fishes which we are talking about are originally from the wild. So we have taken them from the wild, we have cultured them, or we have inbred them in captivity, so that we would be able to enjoy those particular organisms. So for us to enjoy those organisms or the fishes or the plants, they should be hale and healthy. For that matter, what we'll have to do, we will have to provide a particular confinement to them so that they are comfortable enough at home. If they are happy, definitely we'll be happy. So that is what an aquarium is. So it is a particular area where you mimic the environment so that the fishes and the plants will thrive well. So let's get back to a little bit of history, and let's come back to our initial section. This concept of aquarium was initially, way back centuries, was started by John Wolfrey Prawer. This scientist, what she did was, she loved fishes and plants. So she just made a glass confinement and kept these fishes and plants for her attraction and for her research, or for experimenting with these organisms. So she is actually called as mother of aquariophily. So aquariophily is the hobby, like philately, what we call for the stamp collection, numismatics for coin. This hobby of aquarium, it is called as aquariophily. Okay, if you are going to set up an aquarium at home, the first, we have a few basic steps which you will have to follow so that you will have a wonderful aquarium, a beautiful aquarium to enjoy with. I would always suggest, nowadays people are talking about a smaller area, smaller aquarium, a small bowl, or a small rectangular structure. But I would always suggest, when you are planning to go for an aquarium, how much ever possible, obtain an aquarium as large as possible. The reasons I'll tell you later. Because I've had an experience very recently, almost a couple of weeks back. One of my neighbors, he was very much interested in aquarium, but he didn't know what to do. He just went to the shop, got a big glass bowl, got the fishes also, got some substrate, came home, kept the aquarium at home, completely filled it with the substrate, put the water, put the fish in. He was very happy for the first few hours. Everything was clear once he didn't have a light or he didn't have a proper filtration system. The water settled down, it was clear, and the fishes were happy. The next day morning, he saw all the 30 fishes which he had bought completely gone. It was completely dead. Later, he called me, suggesting one of my friends and wanted some help. So then I went there and I told him what to do. Now his aquarium is quite hale and healthy and he is enjoying it. So once you purchase an aquarium, you always purchase the aquarium setup or the components along with it. Make sure you are setting up that aquarium on a sturdy floor or a sturdy table or a draft-free area. Before introducing any kind of fish, you will have to run the aquarium for several hours to make the water mature. Once the water is mature and suitable enough and the temperature is under control and it is in terms with the room temperature, then you can go in for a addition. The last one is cycling the aquarium. Cycling the aquarium, usually what we do is keep some plants, very hardy plants, along with the substrate so that you allow the plants to grow for a few days. What these plants do is, whatever soil substrate which we are adding, the nutrients which are coming out of the substrate will be cycled by these plants. So these plants, what they do, they cycle the nutrients and make the complete atmosphere, complete environment or the small ecosystem biote in good condition for the fishes. So what we are going to talk about here, even though it is a hobby or pet keeping, definitely requires money. You allocate such funds so that you can buy almost an aquarium along with all the components required to hold a fish. When we are talking about fish, it is just not a non-living thing. It is also a living thing and it is also a pet. So you should definitely make a proper arrangement when you are bringing some living organism or a fish to your home. It might cost less or sometimes cost more depending on the variation of aquariums and the fishes you buy. So economy, you will have to keep it aside for this hobby. So aquariums are basically or generally based on two types depending on salinity: marine aquarium and the freshwater aquarium. I am mostly concentrating on the freshwater aquarium. So why not marine? Because I did marine also. So I'm not completely away from marine aquarium. Marine aquarium, we have got wonderful, beautiful fishes. I think you would have yesterday you would have gone through Deepak's presentation. You cannot imagine the color of the fishes which you find in your marine system. The coral reef environment is the house of the beautiful colored fishes in the world. As the color increases or you have the differentiation in color and that awesome look, the maintenance part also is a little bit tough for the marine aquarium. So since we are getting into a beginning stage of aquarium, so we are going to talk about a freshwater aquarium where you can easily begin experimenting your hobby as well as make it into a profitable venture. So when I'm talking about freshwater aquarium, what is a freshwater aquarium? It is a receptacle. It can hold one or more freshwater aquatic organisms, either for a decorative purpose or a pet keeping and research purpose. But here, I would definitely oppose this definition of decorative. So we are not going to have, definitely, whatever you're going to have, it is going to make your household look much better. But since we are dealing with live organisms, we should not only look into that is as a decorative object. Since these organisms are live, hale and healthy, so we should be aware of its biology or we should be aware of its life state. So we can call it a pet keeping. So instead of a receptacle that holds aquatic organisms for pet keeping and certain cases, research purposes. So it is a miniature habitat mimicking the ecosystem of ponds, lakes, rivers, and any other water pool that exists on the land. So this is how the introduction goes. So let's directly get into the concept because there are quite a lot of slides which I'll have to go through. I will rush through, in fact. So maintaining a freshwater aquarium, as I told you, is not as hard as the saltwater aquarium. So for a freshwater pool that exists on the land, which are not mainly affected by the temperature, lighting, or the salinity changes, But whereas in the marine environment, it has got adverse environmental factors. So each and every now and then, there is a difficult state change in the water quality parameters. But for a freshwater system, there is no much change in the water quality parameters, or it can be maintained easier when compared to the saltwater system. Freshwater fish can either be two types, from a cold water or temperate fishes, or from tropical side. Mostly for us, we usually prefer tropical species because they are hard enough to survive. It is easy for us to maintain. Aquariums, you would have seen, definitely they are made up of transparent glasses. Smaller aquariums or huge aquariums are made up of acrylic. And what are the benefits of keeping in ornamental fishes or these freshwater fishes? Definitely, they will give a pressure to the eye. Relaxation of mind is one of the most important things when you have an aquarium at home. For me, all the working hours should be
done. Sir, Yuvraj, sorry to disturb.
Yeah.
There is a noise at the background, sir. We are not able to hear your voice clearly. No, sir. Still, there is some noise.
What kind of noise?
It's like crushing some plastic paper. Some noise is coming in that. You're not able to hear your voice clearly.
Sir. It's from my side, I'll try.
No, sir. It's getting worse. Now it's clear. Now it's clear.
Now?
Yeah, now it's clear. Now it's clear.
Is it fine now?
Yeah, it's fine, sir. It's fine. Good to go. Thank you.
So all the while where I was talking, it was not clear at all.
No, sir. It was only for the last 1 or 2 minutes.
Okay.
So I just stopped you there. Yeah, please.
Okay. So we were talking about the benefits of aquarium keeping. The major thing we look into is the relaxation of mind when we feel tired or depressed. So depression is one important topic of discussion right now, but this will definitely help when you have a relaxing hobby at home. Not only aquarium keeping or any other for that matter. So these ornamental fishes kept in aquarium or garden pool, they become an attractive focal point, even at home or at office or wherever you are keeping them. And also, the hobby of ornamental fish keeping can be also groomed as a source of self-employment. That's what we are going to talk about. What are the fishes and how are we going to make it profitable? Okay, so we'll get into the topic right now. So we are going to talk about ornamental fishes, which are hardy to grow, which is easy to maintain, as well as they should be in the position that they can be bred easily in captivity. Yesterday, Dr. Deepak would have spoken about indigenous fishes or endemic fishes, the fishes which are present in our country, in our coasts, in our valleys and rivers. But in the aquarium industry, our endemic species, like your barbs, denisonis, the corydoras, those fishes, more than that, the imported varieties play a major role in getting funds or in economic wise, the financial wise, these organisms or these imported fishes, they garner lots of attraction from the buyers or from the hobbyists as well. So people you would have known, In fishes, there are two varieties, live bearers and egg layers, viviparous and oviparous. Live bearers or the viviparous group, they are the organisms which can give birth to live and free swimming young ones. These are commonly called as live bearing tooth carps, where the upper and lower jaw, they have teeth. The most common live bearers which we are going to talk about here is the flatty, molly, swordtail and guppy. These are the four major players in the aquarium industry, which moves in volumes. People, they have started breeding it. These are all exotic varieties. These are not at all Indian. These are all exotic varieties, came into India in the almost during 40s, 50s, these organisms were imported in India. From this day onwards, these organisms played a major role in the aquarium industry, and they have started breeding these organisms with 100% success rate. Apart from platy, molly, swordtail, and guppy, there are few more freshwater species which are kept in aquariums, like the halfbeaks, splitfins, or the stingrays even, and the anableps, the four-eyed fish. But these are all very rarely kept in the aquariums when compared to the platy, molly, swordtail, and guppy. These viviparous fishes, they are always considered as a beginner's fish. They can be housed anywhere in the aquarium with any kind of fishes mostly. The problem with these live bearers is mostly they find their own species for reproduction. So creating a new variety of live bearer is quite a little bit of challenge to the hobbyists. Even though we have done or many cross-multiplying or cross-breeding, where we were able to get many colorful varieties. Because when you talk about aquarium fishes, it is always dependent on the color and the size. These are the two major factors which will tag them as an ornamental fish itself. Only when they are colorful enough or quite compatible in size to hold to be kept in an aquarium, only then they will be considered as a aquarium fish. So for getting that particular size and color, there are many inbreeding activities which are going on, from which we can get our desired size and desired color for sales or for the system. Okay, before getting into any organism to be kept at home, we should know what their biology is, what environment they were, and what environment they require, what are the water quality parameters they need, what food they eat. So these are the basic requirements you should know before having any live organisms at home. So getting into live bearers, these live bearers are omnivores. They can eat anything from plants and animal-based foods. Usually, as in animal kingdom, aquatic kingdom, the females are a bit larger than the males. The females can grow up to 2.5 to 5 inches, whereas the males are restricted to 1.5 to 3 inches. To attract the females, the males are usually more colorful, and they possess mainly viviparous fishes. They possess an organ called as gonopodium. It is a modification of the anal fin, which helps the male candidate to deposit the sperm into the female candidate. So the females have rounded body and they possess a gravid spot very anterior dorsal to the anus, where the sperms will be attached. The female live bearers, the speciality is they can store the male sperm for a period of 3 to 4 months minimum. And they can have several broods even if they have mated just once. That is a speciality in this viviparous species. And that is the reason they are hardy and they were able to survive in this industry for a very long time. There are certain modifications in their body structures also, like in swordtail, where a male develops a sword-like tail that is the elongated part of the caudal fin. These are the modifications by the organisms to either attract the female or to carry out the biological functions. So this is how you determine sex in the viviparous species. I have taken a guppy as an example here. So the first picture you are seeing is of a male, where you can find the gonopodium at the end of the anal fin. Near the anal fin, you can find the gonopodium, that a protuberance-like structure. So that is the organ which helps the male to deposit the sperm into the female gravid spot. The female gravid spot, which is found just above the vent of the organism. So live bearers, to keep them, are non-aggressive. They are prolific breeders. They actually, these live bearers, whatever species we are talking about, they mature sexually in 1 to 3 months. Maximum when you buy a fish, most of the times when you get it from a farm or an aquarist, they would be in a mature stage. Only in a very, very few times you get a very small juveniles. And those juveniles, they would be sexually active in 1 to 3 months. The fertilization is internal. So that is the reason they have a good survival rate in the aquarium. These live bearers, they can give birth to successive batches of live young at an interval of 2 days. The first day they are producing almost 20 to 20 clutches. Immediately after 2 to 3 days, they will be able to produce another 20 batch. The only problem with these live bearers or the vivipara species, the adults can exhibit cannibalism. That is, when they are starved or when they don't get a good quantity of food or good quality of food, they can start eating their young ones. So the survival rate depends on this particular cannibalism, this particular behavior of the parents also. When you are breeding, if you are planning to breed, people, what regularly they do is they build traps. Traps, mosquito nets, or plants, a densely populated aquarium. These can be used to avoid cannibalism so that the young ones can hide. Or when you are using net, the young ones will go down, whereas the adult will stay on top, as I showed you in the picture. So this is how you initially maintain a breeding pair of a vivipara fish. Either it can be a molly or guppy or a platy or a swatty. Now we'll get into the major types of fishes which we were talking about. The first thing we are going to see is platy. So this particular platy variety of fish is called as the color king of the live bearer fishes. This is a common name. It is for two related species of freshwater genus in the family, Zippophorus. So Zippophorus is also given for platy, and also it is given for the swatail, Zippophorus maculatus and Zippophorus calari. This is not a native species of India, so it is a native species of Central America and Southern Mexico. This particular platy can suit well in any kind of community aquarium. A planted community aquarium, you can go and buy this platy. And this platy is not only in one color. I'll show you the varieties of platy in the next slides. This platy, since I've told you, it is already native to an area of North and Central America. It has been acclimatized in our conditions for a very longer time. It is an omnivore, and as I told you, the sexes are separate. The males will have a gonopodium and the female will have a gravid spot. The females have a rounded, bulging stomach, and they can grow much larger in size compared to the males. And the breeding, the same thing as I told you. If you have a mating pair, for example, one male or one female will have 2 to 3 males together, or one male will have two females together. You can separate these particular organisms once they reach sexual maturity, that is after 3 to 4 months. Keep them separately in a planted tank or a tank with nets to prevent cannibalism. So if you have it with dim lights, automatically these colorful fellows, they'll start breeding, and you can definitely enjoy the offsprings of them. And what do they need in an aquarium? What is the requirement, or what is the water quality parameters they need? pH should always be on the neutral side or the alkaline side. So 7 to 8 is much preferred in an aquarium. Hardness, it can vary up to 9 to 19 dH. Temperature 18 to 25 degrees is always optimal for any kind of aquarium. Even though we call them tropical, it is not that they can be kept at 35 degrees or 40 degrees. They prefer a water temperature of 18 to 25 degrees where they can grow well with their bright colorations. As I told you, the floating plants or any thin leaf rooted plants can be used to provide shelter for the young ones. So classification, I'm not going to touch here because that is going to be a separate class. So we'll get into the different varieties of platies. And I'm not going to completely again tell you about all these three, all the details about these fishes, because once I start with southern platy fish, I've almost got another 10 more platies to consider. So I'm not going to consider, because as a platy, they all have a common behavior, as I told you earlier. They have a common pattern on the common breeding structure or a breeding behavior, and almost all the biology will be same. These slides, the upcoming slides, are just to show you what are the available platy species which you can definitely get into. So the first is the southern platypus or the Xiphophorus maculatus, the common one, which you are seeing. It is also called as a common platy or a Mickey Mouse platy or a moonfish. The next variety you see here is on the picture, variatus. You have different colors rather than the normal red. The normal platy is almost orange, bright orange color, but variatus platy is different color. These are all the causes of inbreeding, of different generation of inbreeding. So we were able to get these many colors of fishes. Generally, as I told you, these platy are very hardy nature, hardy fishes, which can be kept in any community aquarium, and preferably, they would prefer the tag mates of Colissa, Poecilia, Xiphophorus, Corydoras, or Lochirans. Colissa are the gouramis. They are endemic. Our Indian gouramis are also present. Colissa lalea, yesterday, I think Dr. Deepak would have shown you a bright colored dwarf gourami. Poecilia are the mollies, black molly, white molly, which you would have seen. Xiphophorus, again, the same species. Corydoras are common cat, smaller catfishes, which are, even we do have an endemic Corydoras here. And loricarids, another variety of catfish, which stays at the bottom of the substrate. So these are the other different varieties of platies which you can definitely come across in the market. The red platy or the black-tailed platy, tuxedo, the gold twin bar, the rainbow platy, the sunset platy. So these are certain varieties of platy which you can keep them in community. You can almost get all these colors, keep them in your tank, or you, if you want to crossbreed them, you can definitely utilize one male or a female of different species of these platies, and you can go ahead with your breeding. The next most important vivipara species is the molly. Molly is the common name which is derived from the genus Molinacea, but later now it has been changed to Poecilia. These are also from the native of America, Central America to Mexico. Almost 39 species of different species of Molinacea or Poecilia are recorded. Among these Poecilia, there are two species which are critically endangered also, the Poecilia sulfuraria and the Poecilia latipunctata. These are present in the Mexico, the lakes of Mexico. But initial days, what happened was, due to unjudicial fishing for this aquarium hobby, these species were almost, they were completely gone to a level of extinction. Now they are critically endangered under the IUCN list. The classification I'm not getting into, again, the biology. The same like your platy, the female molly is rounded, that of a male is slender. Unlike your platy, molly attains maturity in almost 4 months. It can breed 6 to 8 times in a year. In one clutch, you can find young ones ranging from 20 numbers to 100 numbers. The maximum size it can grow is up to 5 inches, and the lifespan almost 2 to 4 years if you keep it under good condition with good quality water parameters. These are again the varieties of mollies which you can definitely get. Sailfin molly, Poecilia latipinna. So this is one important molly variety where now it has become very less. Initially, this sailfin molly had a good market, but now we are not getting the original variety of sailfin molly where the dorsal fin is beautifully positioned in the form of a sail. The Dalmatian molly, the white molly, a common molly which you would have already seen. The silver molly, a more slender type of molly among these different mollies present. Balloon molly, I think the picture is distorted. I will give it to you later then. The spotted molly or the marble molly. See, all the biology, the characteristics, the feeding behavior, the requirements, they all same for all the mollies, but the varieties differ. The Amazon molly, Pacific molly, the Yucatan sailfin molly, and the chocolate molly. See, I'm not talking about fishes which you cannot get it, which is not available in India. We can definitely get all these types of variety which is available in the aquarium trade. So you need not worry about getting a different kind of molly for your aquarium. You can find all these fishes in any good aquarium, with any good aquarium. The black molly, a common molly which we regularly use, the Poecilia spinops, and the goldus molly. The next important fish we are going to talk about is swordtail. This swordtail almost became an aquarium fish in 1910. It was also known as a moonfish because of the caudal fin. It had a moon-like structure, the half moon-like structure, so it was called as moonfish. It was a good subject for selective breeding. So these fishes were selectively bred for giving good quality colors and to develop even a longer swordtail. It is derived, the swordtail is derived from the elongated lower lobe of the male caudal fin. This particular sword it is not only to attract the females, it also acts as a lever for jumping. This particular species, the swordtail, are very good jumpers. If you have an open aquarium and you're going to have male swordtails inside it, you better be careful. Definitely they'll jump out of your aquarium unless and until if you are closing it. They also use this particular sword as a rudder for steering. These swordtails, when compared to platy, are much slender and they are most like a torpedo shape. A very, very distinguished shape the swordtails are. So the classification, again, we are not going to talk about it. So biology, the swordtail possesses a bulky body when compared to the other ones. The sexes are separate and the adults can sexually mature within 6 to 8 weeks. The same thing, you have your gonopodium and your gravid spot. The culture and breeding almost resembles all the vivipara species. You need not worry about one particular kind of fish you got or different kinds of fish, but the methodology to rear the young ones or maintain the adults at home remains the same for most of all the vivipara species. The swordtails exhibit sex reversal. This is one important aspect about swordtail. In the absence of males in a group, in case when you're buying fishes or when you have bred fishes, in an absence of a male, the older female has the ability to transform into a male, the protogynous. So this is where a female is transformed into a male to make the community grow. Female to male change is very common, but male to protogynous, I mean protandrous, is very, very rare. A male to female change is quite rare in swordtails, but definitely adult female can easily change into a male when conditions require. These particular swordtails, they also exhibit sex reversal depending on the pH in which they live. The pH of the water, if it is about 5 and 6, mostly you can find males are developed. When the pH is raised above 7, it is greater than 7, then the population will have the more number of females. You can definitely try it at home when you have time. So this is the one major variety of the swordtail, the green swordtail or the red swordtail, the Zeophorus hellerii. These organisms, even the platy or the molly or the swordtails, they all come from highly vegetated rivers. They always prefer a good plantation so that it can hide. They have the complete habit of hiding and swimming in the open waters. So definitely when you have an aquarium and when you are going to hold these Zeophorus swordtails or platys or mollies, you this better you have a good planted aquarium. The male can grow up to a length of 14 centimeters, including the sword I'm talking about. A female will have a much bigger body, but the females won't have a sword. This is another variety of swordtail, the Chiapa swordtail or the Montezuma swordtail, which is commonly called as Monty. The neon swordtail, which has a glow at the ventral side, and the pineapple swordtail, a good colored swordtail, which are all causes of inbreeding. The species and genus are the same, but the different colorations have come forward with different kinds of inbreeding, which has taken place for a year long time. The hyphen, I think the picture is distorted here too. The red wagtail and the hyphen lyretail. So these are the varieties which is available in India, and you can definitely try them out in your aquarium or as a culture for breeding it at home. Or when you are going to utilize it commercially, it is better you have cement tanks rather than glass tanks. Glass tanks, which is best suited when you have it in your home, but a cement tank would be much preferable one when you are going to start for a breeding tank. The next most important and the most sought after fish are the guppies, the smallest of all the vivipara species and highly colorful fishes also. So this was also known as million fish because they were able to breed in millions, in fact. So that is a common name given to it, but they can breed in huge numbers when kept in an aquarium. It is one of the most traded ornamental fishes, and it was named after Robert John Lechmere Guppy. He was a British scientist who discovered this fish in Trinidad. Trinidad was in West Indies. So almost during the 1800s, these guppies were introduced into aquariums. Initially, this particular guppy species was named as Girardinus Guppy, in honor of the discoverer, and later it was changed into Poecilia. Poecilia reticulata is the current scientific name of this particular guppy. So guppies, they can grow to 2 to 3 inches in size. It can attain maturity in 4 to 5 months. they can breed almost 8 to 10 times in a year. Almost every month or every week, they can start breeding. The lifespan ranges for about 2 years maximum in captivity. This mosquito, this guppy, and the relative of it, the Gambusia affinis, you would have known. These varieties were initially utilized for eradicating mosquito larvae, because these are fond of mosquito larvae and they can definitely feed on mosquito larvae in any kind of system. So they were initially brought by certain governments to eradicate mosquito larvae in the fields. And later, because of the coloration, they got into the aquarium trade. So important varieties include the grass guppy, the cobra guppy, the mosaic, and the tuxedo. These are all available in the Indian market, and it has been bred successfully. So this picture I have shown you already. The male guppy will have a gonopodium, that is in the number one. Female guppy will have a gravid spot, that is two. So this is the similarity, this is actually taken as example when you differentiate sexual in ornamental fishes. So what are all the tank mates you can include with these guppy? Angels, when we are talking about angels, I'll talk about them later also. These are the only cichlid fishes which can be kept in a community tank. Whereas the other cichlids, the Malawian cichlids or the Lake Tanganyikan cichlids, it is not preferred to have them in community aquariums as they are aggressive. Unlike their family, cichlid family, these angelfish are the most angelic fishes you would see in a community tank. So these tank mates of Poecilia would definitely include angelfishes, Corydoras, Platy, and Molly. The better fishes to avoid are Gouramis, paradise fish, the Siamese fighting fish, and Central and South American cichlids, as I told you. So these fishes will definitely swallow your guppy as a whole. Next, we are getting into the common egg-layers in an aquarium. Among the common egg-layers, the barbs are the most important group among the egg-layers which we are talking about. So the barbs are the endemic or the indigenous species of India. So they come under Cyprinidae family. The egg-layers, they are classified in two types, one with parental care and the other without parental care. There are certain fishes which will brood the eggs in their mouth, take care until it hatches. But there are certain fishes which will not have parental care. They just scatter the eggs in the water. Even if they are scattering, there are two types of egg layers based on the scattering of eggs. One is adhesive eggs and the other one is non-adhesive eggs. Once they are scattered, these eggs will go and stick themselves to any substrate present. There are certain non-adhesive eggs which will start floating in the water, and wherever they find a spot, they will start to develop there. These egg layers, as I told you earlier, there are egg burriers, mouth incubators, nest builders, egg carriers. These are varieties of egg-laying fishes by how they are taking care of their eggs. For example, the Carassius auritus or the goldfish angel, that is egg burriers. Mouth incubators are angel fishes. Nest builders are Siamese fighting fish. Egg carriers are koi carps, the Cyprinus carpio. So these are a variety of barbs which we will definitely come across in the aquariums of India. So these are native to India and we can be proud of it because they are exported in large quantities to many countries. The tiger barb, one of the most important and the most colorful barbs which you can come across in our western coast, western area, and Denisoni, a native of Kerala. And the filament barb, you can find it in the lakes and rivers of Odisha, and the ticto barb, it is also called a cherry barb. You can find it in the Odisha coast, whatever the inland waters of Odisha and Calcutta. Classification, definitely not now, because that is one different chapter. The species of barbs, they are mainly belong to the genus of Punteus. This is what you will have to know. These barbs are smaller in size, very much suitable for the aquarium, except for one exception is the tinfoil barb, which can grow up to almost 1 foot. So there you need a tank to suit those particular tinfoil barbs. And this particular tinfoil barb is the only vegetarian in the barb family. So except other for this tinfoil barb, the tiger barb, rosy barb, cherry barb, or the ruby barb, they're all omnivores. They can eat any live matter, or you can give them vegetable as well as the animal feeds. They can grow between 5 to 10 centimeters, not more than that. As usual, the females are much larger than the males. These particular species are always kept in groups. They prefer in groups because they are active shoaling fishes, all the barbs. They like to travel in groups. So this is how you can make them less aggressive. If you are keeping them maybe one or two, they might develop aggressiveness in the community tank. But when you are keeping them in shoals or in a group, the aggression is limited. These particular fishes can live almost to 4 or 5 years in home aquarium, depending on the water quality, it's to be maintained. So as I told you, this should be kept in shoals. A minimum tank capacity of 45 liters aquarium is recommended for these barbs. Exception is the tinfoil barb, where you need at least 250 liters. Those are the very huge barb variety. They are very hardy fish, and they prefer a temperature of 20 to 27 degrees. As I told you, not our room temperature, the water temperature is maximum. If you maintain it 27, it is optimum. Water exchange is a must in whatever aquarium you are maintaining. 25% of water exchange every 1 or 2 weeks, it is recommended for any kind of aquarium. It is not that you are having a good filter or a good plants or good lighting, doesn't matter. Make sure your environment or the environment which you are giving to the fish is fresh as how we live in. So they need a fresh, lively environment every week. So you keep exchanging water 20 to 25 to 30%. It is strongly recommended. So as I told you, these fishes are omnivores. They happily feed on worms, crustaceans, insects, and whatever plant matter available. Exception is tinfoil. They prefer vegetable diet. You can feed the fishes what they can eat within a few minutes. See, that is one mistake what the aquarist hobbies at home do. The fishes will start eating. We would like the fishes to eat more. So we put more feed to the aquarium, but that will definitely deteriorate your water quality. A minimum feeding of the fishes will keep them healthier compared to highly fed fishes. We can feed them when they are in the breeding condition. But when you are holding them in captivity for the regular hobby purpose, it is always better to feed them twice a day with an amount, whatever the feed food the fish can eat within a minute or two. So these are barbs are among the easier fishes which can be easy to breed, and especially tiger fishes, which we have bred in our regular aquarium tanks. Even in a community aquarium, they are capable of breeding. So if you maintain a good water quality parameter with good vegetation, definitely you can breed these fishes at home itself. They can produce large numbers of fry after successful prawning because they are egg layers. So these eggs get attached to any substrate. With a good supply of oxygen, with a good flow of water, definitely the eggs which are spawned, they can hatch into fry, and within 3-4 days you can find the fry hatching out of the eggs under good water quality parameters. The next most important fish is the goldfish. So any aquarist or any hobbyist, the initial first fish which comes to the mind is the goldfish. This originated in China. So they have almost 150 types of goldfishes available. Even in Chennai, if you come across any aquarium shop, you can find almost 8 to 9 fishes, types of goldfishes, which are kept in the aquarium. It's an egg scatterer, and it has got adhesive eggs. These eggs are capable of attaching themselves to any substrate. So in the flow of water, they will not be wasted. So they'll be particularly in one area, and they hatch themselves out. It is well suited for a community aquarium, but not definitely for a planted aquarium, because these goldfishes they can graze through any kind of vegetations you have. So biology, they are omnivore. They can eat vegetable matter as well as the live matter what you are giving. Sexes are separate. One thing you can identify a male and a female goldfish only after they sexually mature. The males will develop tubercles on the head and in the operculum. Operculum is the covering of the gills. You can find a small tube-like structures extending from it. In females, the belly bulging will be prominent. Genital opening will be rounded and protruded in female when compared to the males. You can find different coloration in the operculum and the head during the sexual maturity in males. The goldfishes are sought to live up to 20 years under proper captive conditions. pH of the water definitely is 7 to 8. Water hardness 9 to 19 dH. Temperature, as I told you, they are a little bit of tropical fishes. They can extend up to 29 degrees, but you always prefer a temperature of 27 to 28 is better. They prefer to have hydrilla or all well-rooted plants with them because the eggs can go and attach themselves to these kinds of plants. So broodstock, because this is one important fish, you will have to know about how you develop a broodstock for cultivation. You should take or you should select a fish which is 8 to 15 months old. A weight approximately 40 to 100 grams. You can feed them with tubifex, dry worms, morning and evening, or formulated feed, which is available in the market at 10% of body weight per day. So this is if you feed the broodstock in this manner, definitely you will have a good clutch of eggs. For larval rearing, 27 to 28 degrees is preferred. You can have one female with two males in the ratio, sex ratio. So these will definitely move in pair. And after the courtship, the female releases the eggs, and which is fertilized by the sperm from the male. So the fertilization here occurs externally. When compared to the live bearers, where it is internal fertilization, here it is completely external fertilization. The eggs are transparent and dead eggs are opaque. It can be removed by us. These eggs can be collected separately, kept in normal condition. It can hatch within 3 days. Once hatched, you can give them infusoria, that is mustard larvae, boiled egg yolk, microworms, Daphne or tubifix, which are definitely available in the market. Tank mix, they prefer a community tank where they have Polisa, Poecilia, Zephyrophorus, Cordoros, and Lochiorhynchus. These are certain varieties of goldfishes which you just go through. It is available in plenty in our area itself. But nothing is endemic. They are all completely imported. They are exotic fishes. And now they have been inbred in our country for a very long time. So the black moor definitely would have come across, the bubble-like goldfish, the celestial eye, the comet. And to summarize all, these are varieties of goldfish. The common gold, lionhead, red cap, wheel tail, fan tail, pearl scale. Pearl scale is also a very good variety of goldfish to have it in aquarium. The ryukin, the telescopic eyes, oranda. Oranda is a little bit of dwarfish side when compared to the other fishes. Lanchu and the shimbukin, a slender goldfish. The next important egg layer are the koi carps. But these koi carps are preferably kept in garden pools, not in the aquariums inside at home. If I'm exceeding the time limit, please let me know. I can rush through.
No, sir. We have another 10 more minutes.
Just 10 more minutes. I've got another 20 more slides. I don't know. Okay. Let me finish it off.
Okay, sir. You can take your own time, sir. The participants are interested and they will be spending another 10 more minutes is also fine. Not a problem. Okay.
I'll try to just finish it off soon.
Yes, sir.
Anyway,
yes.
So kois, as I told you, they are kings of pond fish. They can spawn almost 1,000 eggs at a time in a duration of 4 to 7 days. So feeding is one important part where you'll have to look into to maintain these aquarium fishes, either at garden pools or a cement tank or in the aquarium. Because a good quality feed and a good time of feeding will definitely help them to stay for a longer time and breed for a longer time, in fact. So the next important, the kings of aquarium or kings of planted aquarium, are the tetras. The tetras, they bring the delicate beauty to any home freshwater aquarium. If you can see the picture, you would understand. Very small fish, but in groups, they would be very divine in your aquarium. With all plants at the background, this red and blue in the foreground, it would be definitely awesome. So it has got a bright blue stripe contrasted by the lower stripe. This particular cardinal tetra, it has got a cousin called as neon tetra. These might look similar, but the stripes of the stripes which run through the body, for the cardinal tetras, it can run through the entire length, whereas neon tetras, it runs only the halfway. I'll show you the neon tetra also. They're very peaceful tetras. They can school together, they show together in brilliant display of color. The cardinal tetras will definitely accept any small foods which suits its mouth size, like brine shrimp, Daphnia, or freeze-dried breadworms are highly preferred. Micro pellet food, definitely. In the initial aquarium tanks where you own it as a hobby, you can go in for micro pellet food. The next common variety which you would see is black widow tetra. Again, so these are all tetras which will definitely move in groups. So you need to have a good sized aquarium with lot amount of green plants in it. So it will have a splendor to an eye. But one problem with these tetras, they are egg layers, as I told you. Once the eggs are laid or scattered,
it is always better to remove the eggs from the parent, because these parents, whatever fits in their mouth, they'll eat it, even be their own eggs. So it is always better, once you have seen, I think there are many questions popping up in the chat box. Once I complete it, I'll definitely answer these questions.
Sure, sir. I'll keep a track of the questions, sir.
Yeah, thanks, Vijay. So once these eggs are fertilized, it is better to remove the eggs from the parent so that you can at least have a good survival rate. The feeding is all similar to all the tetras, so you need not worry about it. So this is a neon tetra, where you can find the halfway through, the neon is halfway through and the red is halfway through. But whereas in the cardinal, you would have seen a complete length of the whole body, you would find that particular blue and red tint. So I'm not going to get into this again. So it's almost similar to whatever we have seen in cardinal. The next one is hockey stick tetra. It is because of the color of the black, which runs to the lateral line till the caudal fin, it resembles a hockey stick, so it is called a hockey stick tetra, the thyaria. Again, they'll need, these tetras definitely need lots of hiding spaces in the form of plants or driftwoods or rocks, so that they can hide, and definitely they can breed when you provide them with these particular necessary, the breeding system or the breeding tank separately, when you have lots of plants in them. So the number of plants increases, it helps in the survivability of the young ones or the eggs. The next one are these zebra danios, which you would have commonly come across from an age-old practice. We have been growing the zebra danios, and this particular zebra danio were the initial fishes which were used for transgenic studies. The genetic studies, these zebra danios were used. This is the original coloration of zebra danio, but now we even have a pinkish color or a greenish zebra, all because of inbreeding. So this particular striped zebra pattern is very, very familiar with aquarium hobbyists. It is a perennial favorite for freshwater enthusiasts. So anytime you find a zebra, you will definitely find it attractive to put it in your aquarium. Again, these peaceful fishes, they need to be kept in schools. They are non-aggressive, definitely. And generally, zebra danios, they have a very loyal relationship, a loyal relationship with the females. One male will definitely go with one female till they live in together, they hatch young ones, and they rear the young ones. Almost 300 to 400 eggs definitely will be produced in a clutch. And within 2 days, if you have a good setup or a good water quality parameter, they'll hatch. Live food, brine shrimp is always preferred live food for any larval fish which you're going to rear. Brine shrimp, as a cyst, it is available in market. You can get the cyst, hatch it, give the nauplia to the fries. They will happily eat it, and they'll start growing with good coloration. In the breeding tank of zebras, it is always better to have fine leaf plants where you can attach their eggs. So this is one of my favorites, in fact, even though it is a cichlid, but when it comes to an aquarium, community aquarium, this will complete aquarium as a whole. This gentle, as the name suggests, dainty the fishes coming from the genus Pterophyllum, they are cichlids, but completely different behavior of a cichlid. They can get along with all community fishes, even though they are predators, like the cichlid instinct definitely would be there, but they can definitely get along with the other fishes also. Unfortunately for this fish, for any egg layer in fact, except for goldfish or koi carps, males and females distinguish characters are quite difficult. Unless and until they are completely matured, you can't find a complete distinguished characteristic of a male and a female. They can live up to 5 years in an aquarium. These particular Pterophyllum species, as told for zebra, they are monogamous pair. One male and one female will be there. They will lay eggs, and they have a good parental care. They raise their young ones till the larvae are free swimming. This particular Pterophyllum, they have one bad behavior. What it is, when you remove a breeding pair, maybe a male or a female, it seems that either those two will not pair mate with any other fishes which you are going to live inside. Any female or male which you again introduce in the aquarium, they will definitely not courtship. So they have a long-term relationship where individuals will protect the other from threats and potential suitors. That is the problem. They'll become very territorial once they have started. when they under courtship. So if one male is fixed with the female, definitely it will not allow the other males to get into their territory. Immediately, if that is the case, there'll be an aggressive fight, which may lead in the death of other male fishes also. So as I told you, upon the death or removal of one mated pair, we have experienced that there'll be a refusal of remaining mate to any other pair of angelfish. That is one peculiar character of this particular angel. This angelfish, when the pair is ready to spawn, they choose an appropriate medium or a very clean place they need. Either if they don't find a clean place, they'll start making a clean place for themselves, and they will attach their egg. Once they have attached the eggs, the male will start taking care in turns. Even the female will start both. They will keep fanning the eggs to provide a necessary oxygen. Once it is done, the eggs will hatch within 4 to 5 days under good water quality conditions, and that the young ones will be free swimming. And in that case, initially they will have a good parenticle, because cichlids as a whole, they are fishes which will take care of their young ones till they grow well. So almost 1,000 eggs would be laid. It depending on the tank size which you have or the parameters which you have. With the health of the female fish, the number of eggs might change with the size and health of the female fish. Once you give them a good quality food, the female fish is healthier and with a good size, and it can lay up to 1,200 eggs, or else 100, 200, 300, it depends on the size. Please note down, this particular brine shrimp will always be a suitable choice for any culture you are going to have. If you forget any other feed or larval culture, you always prefer brine shrimp, which is easy to hatch in our home system. So that is why I'm stressing on this brine shrimp. Even you have many other microfix, tubifix worms or daphnia or rotifers, but these brine shrimps are easy to hatch at home itself. The next beautiful fish is the Siamese fighter fish. This particular Siamese fighter fish is native of Thailand or Cambodia. So they were completely got from those areas, but now it has been bred in our conditions. These are anabantoids. The peculiar specialty of this particular fish, the Siamese fighter or gourami or the paradise fish, they have labyrinth organ. They can breathe oxygen from the atmosphere. So even though if your water quality has lesser oxygen, they can easily survive with the atmospheric oxygen. That is how you will see many fighter fishes are kept in small containers like glass tumblers or glasses, wine glasses. So they can survive in any area because they are not aggressive swimmers. They are very, very slow swimmers. They won't utilize the metabolic energy. They can survive on oxygen from the atmosphere itself. But as the name suggests, in community tanks, there are possibilities of internal fighting. So they can easily kill other male Siamese spider or any other fish which competes him for either space or food. So I'm not going to get into the structure and function and all. As I told you, these are normal things which you can come across. We'll directly get into the breeding. So these, as they are fighting fishes, they are quite aggressive towards one another. When we are introducing a pair to courtship, which will last for 2 weeks, you give live food, not the prepared food. Live food is preferred. Frozen food is also a good option. If you have frozen artemia, that is fine. These pair, when you put inside initially, it should be carded from each other. That is, you make them separate initially for quite some time till they get acclimatized. Then you can remove the card so that they can get together for courtship. It is always preferable to have a temperature of 26 to 28, as I already told you. And one more important thing which you will have to look into when you are going to breed these betas or the fighter fish, you can add Indian almond leaves or normal almond leaves which falls from the tree. You can add it in the water. That will give a dark tea color. And this will create an environment suitable for breeding of these particular fishes. So this is how they prepare a nest, a bubble nest, where the female first goes and attaches itself to the eggs, and the male will fertilize it with his sperms there. This is one specific habit of these fishes, which makes the survival ability much higher. They don't scatter, but they stick it to the bubble trap or the bubble nest. So this is how a nest would look in an aquarium, when you're going to have a breeding tank, when you find a foam or bubbles in the top, you should definitely be sure that there are some phytofish inside which are spawning. The next important fish, gourami. I think yesterday Deepak would have shown this figure again. This is an Indian, typical Indian kolisa, the dwarf gourami. These are also, they are also air breathers. They can breathe from the atmosphere with the help of the labyrinth organs. Breeding, we'll detect into the breeding. These are all egg layers, and they also, like the Siamese spider fish, they build very beautiful bubble nest. When you have a good pair inside, you can be assured of a bubble nest, and these gouramis will easily pair and breed in an aquarium. But they should have a quite high aquarium rather than having a flat aquarium. They should have a good filtration system, but that filtration system should not produce strong current, because this bubble nest can distort, or they will get moved away or blown away with strong current. So it is always better to have a very slow moving current or a filter when you have the Siamese fighter or a gourami or a paradise fish. They are highly territorial, as I told you, for the fighter fish also. Live plants are the best advisable option for having a breeding setup for this fighter fish and gouramis. Where we'll have to wait till the female becomes gravid. Only then you can easily you can feed them with meaty foods like breadworms and brine chips. So it makes the female easily gravid for fertilization. Lighting is always better to be subdued in breeding tank. When you are having it in common aquarium, that's fine. But when you are going to have it for a breeding tank, it is, you have a lighting, a very less lighting. Temperature, you don't worry about any change in temperature. You always maintain your tanks at 25 to 27 degrees, that is optimum. pH, again, 7 to 8, don't worry about any other thing. So this is how a bubble nest is built in a normal tank, where the kolisa will develop a bubble nest. The males will carry the eggs and stick it in the bubble nest. Even if you find it in the background, you would find some other fishes also living there. So even in community aquarium, these gouramis are, they can breed. So that is what I'm coming to tell them. This is what I will do. They have almost 600 eggs at a clutch. The gourami, they'll have a, if you watch these gouramis in an aquarium, you can find a good courtship behavior will be seen. Once the courtship is done, the female will be ready to deposit the eggs. The eggs will be carried and placed in the bubble nest by the male. Almost 600 to 700 eggs, you can find in single clutch. So another 24 hours maximum, you will find hatching taking place. 3 to 5 days, you can find a free swimming fry in your breeding aquarium. Again, feed the gourami fry with the newly hatched brine chip, Nopley. The next most important, a big fish, which you're going to see, is the Oscar. See, I'm giving topics. I mean, I'm talking about fishes which are common and which will be easy to breed. See, there are many more fishes in the aquarium industry which you can try breeding out, but the fishes which I've shown you is easy to breed and easy to maintain in a house aquarium. See, Oscar fish, or the Astronautus oscillatus, it is again from the South American area. These fishes will not be advisable to be kept at community aquariums. They are fin nippers and they can eat any kind of smaller fishes, which is up to mouth size, they can easily swallow. See, Oscars will have a complete territory, will be aggressive towards the other fish encroaching their territory. They can easily be paired with, once they are paired, they will not allow any other fish to come nearby. So this particular species are regarded as sexually monomorphic because they'll have different male and different female. So they have you can identify the females and the males by the dark patches around the abdomen of the male. Females will be much subdued. Fecality, they'll lay up to 1,000 to 3,000 eggs once they are paired. They can live in an aquarium for almost nearly up to 10 years. If we all keep the other parameters clean, they'll live up to 10 years. The females will lay the eggs on a flat surface. It will not lay it on a substrate. You should be sure when you're holding an Oscar, they will not put it on the gravel substrate. They will only put it on a flat surface, like a flat rock or a flat glass, when you keep it for during the breeding. The eggs will hatch within 3 days maximum when it is attached to the yolk, and the fry which are emerging from the egg will live for another 1 week with the help of the yolk, which is already present in the egg. Again, newly hatched brine shrimp is always better. This is another fish, a very beautiful fish and very easy to maintain fish, a giant five-mouth cichlid. This particular cichlid, like in Oscars, they form a monogamic pair, male and female. They prefer their own territory. They clean their territory. They lay the eggs maybe in 4 to 6 months if they are paired enough. These eggs will be completely taken care by the parents. They are mouth brooders. So once the young ones hatch and go out, even if there is any agitation to the tank or any vibration in the tank, immediately they'll suck all the young ones, the adult fries, the young fries in their mouth and keep it safe. And again, leave it once the system is okay. So they can, the female will deposit almost 100 to 500 eggs on a clean substrate. It is very, very easy to breed. If you get a good pair of this five-mouth cichlid, it will definitely breed in your own tank itself. Even in a community tank with good hiding places, they can easily breed. Next, last aspect, we'll get into the aquarium plants. We'll finish off with this another five slides maximum. Because these aquarium plants may play a major role in making your aquarium more bright, more colorful, more pleasant, as well as for breeding good quality of fishes. So these will form the base of the food chain. I'm not going to talk about those things now. So types of the aquatic plants in an aquarium are three types: semi-terrestrial, truly aquatic, and marginal. Now we'll talk only about the truly aquatic ones. Here we have got submerged plants, where the entire plant stem, roots, and leaf are submerged. Under the submerged plant, there are two types: the rooted plants and the bunch plants. Simple example for rooted plants, a common variety which we have come across is Vallisneria. They have got good roots. They can grow well in a community aquarium. They can grow well for breeding tanks also. Bunch plants, usually these can be cut and they are cultivated just by cutting. They don't have a particular root type system. They can be just hung in the or immersed or in the substrate itself. Simple example is Kabumbo and Bacopa. Floating plants we would have come across are Pistia and Lemna in our early stages. These floating plants are preferable for breeding tanks. In community tanks, they might hinder the motion of the water circulation. In breeding tanks, they are much preferred. Emergent varieties like Nymphaea, that is lily, is much suited with their rhizome. It is easy to cultivate this lily with the help of the rhizome. If you cut the rhizome into two, place it in different parts, they'll start growing into new Nymphaea. Some important aquarium plants for your information. The Acorus, the sweet flag, commonly available. It was got from Indonesia. It is available in our condition right now. They prefer slightly acidic water when comparatively to the other ones. When in a community aquarium, this will be maintained by water circulation. So you need not worry about the pH when you are having this particular plant. The propagation of this particular plant is done by cutting the root stock. When the root is cut into two different pieces and put it in different area, it will start growing. The one important variety of the aquarium which we have is Vallisneria, the eelgrass. It is found in almost all South Asian waters. They have bright ribbon-like leaves. It is always suitable when you have these Vallisneria in your background. The next important is the Amazon sword plant, the Echinodorus. Very good bunch leaf plants. They are strictly rooted. You can easily cut the roots and start growing the new plants. They can easily be propagated itself in the aquarium. Hygrophila, another fast-growing plant in an aquarium, Hygrophila deformis. You can cut any part of the plant, keep it in an aquarium, it'll start growing into a new plant. So you not worry about propagating it. You will not find it difficult to propagate it, because the roots will start growing from each and every nodes of the plant. And one more beautiful plant is the arrowhead, the Sagittaria. A rosette type of plant which grows on a rhizome. Easy to breed in an aquarium. Once you have all these plants which I've told you in an aquarium, with good lighting, with an 8-hour photo period, and good water quality circulation, you can definitely grow them. You can definitely breed them in your own tanks. Because many of the plants which we are talking about right now are either runners, creepers, or rhizomes, so it can be easily cut and developed into new plants. So submerged plants, hydrilla. We would have come across this particular plant during our school days also when we're studying about oxygen consumption in plants. Hydrilla is found in any pond occurring in your nearby vicinity. You can take this hydrilla, wash it carefully, because certain plants, when you get it from the aquarium shop, they will harbor snails. The snails, what will they do? They'll lay the eggs in the plants and they leave. Once you keep it in your aquarium, this will start propagating and You cannot control the snails at all. So whenever you are buying a plant from a shop, make sure you are disinfecting with potassium permanganate for at least few seconds to get rid of the eggs of the snails. Hydrilla is one variety. Najas is another variety which can grow rapidly in an aquarium. It's a flowering plant. If they are maintained well, you can find a small white to pink flowers in the top. Ceratophyllum is another variety which you can easily grow in any kind of aquarium, even in dim lights. They have very fine leaves and they are best suited for live bearers and egg layers for in the breeding tanks. Floating plants, Lemna, the duckweeds, which will cover the surface, because when you're having a common community aquarium, it is not artificial, because they will block the light passing through the planted aquariums. If it is better to have it in their breeding tanks. Azolla, you could have come across in any water stagnated pools, the duckweed. And Pistia, a quite beautiful plant to look at. It will have hanging roots at the bottom. In breeding tanks or in tanks where you have Siamese fighter and Gaurami, you can hold this Pistia to have a good quality bubble nest. So emergent, as I told you, the lilies. The lily and the water lotus, which can be kept in a bigger aquarium, not a smaller aquarium. Bigger aquarium definitely have, and it's a rhizome plant. The stem also starts creeping. You can cut and you can develop it into a new plant. So conditions the same. You maintain a pH of 6.5 to 7.5 or 7 to 8, that is fine. Temperature should always be kept from 25 to 28. It is ideal for any kind of plants or fishes. Light is one important thing which you will have to maintain in the planted tanks, where a good photo period of 8 hours is advisable. See, when people will be fond of fishes, they keep the light on for many hours together. So that is not advisable. If you have a light duration, you try to find a timer so that you can cut the photo period. Plant substrate, for when you're having natural plants, it is definitely good to get a nourishing substrate to be kept in an aquarium. So these aquariums will add a good look to your aquarium. Not only the good look, it will also keep the water quality by binding up and clearing organic waste. They convert carbon dioxide into oxygen, which will be suitable for the fishes also. So many fishes which we are utilizing in an aquarium, they come from areas where it is densely vegetated. So it is always preferable to have good planted set system in your aquarium when you are going to have any kind of fish. So nitrogen cycle, I'm not going to talk about now. It is already late, I think so. So thank you again for the opportunity provided. I hope this session would have at least given you a few information about what kind of fishes to have, what kind of plants you can have, and what kind of setup you can have for breeding. And question, maybe Vijay Kumar, I can think, and you can go ahead.
Yes, sir. Thank you, Dr. Yuvraj. So it was a very informative and useful session. And we would like to thank you very much for this session. And there is a lot of comments from the participants in both YouTube as well as in Zoom. They have appreciated the presentation and they love the presentation like anything. And sorry for the introduction. I think rather than introducing you as a professor in biotechnology, I should have introduced you as a professional aquarist.
In fact, I would like to be called
that. Yes, sir.
In such a way.
So henceforth, I'll do the introductions like that. Anyway, sir, let us go to the questions one by one. The first question is a person is asking whether we can identify gender of guppy fishes with color.
See, identification with color is quite a bit difficult, because in the morphology itself, you can easily identify the guppy. You need not go deeply into the color or any other characteristic. Males are always smaller and central with good color. Females, a bulkier, rounded body. So that's it. So just seeing the morphology itself, you can easily identify a guppy, because the guppy, female guppy, will have a rounded tail with an elongated rounded body, whereas the male guppy will have a fan tail with a slender body.
Okay, sir. Another question, can flower horns be kept with mollies or guppies?
Never. Definitely don't ever try to keep a flower horn with mollies and guppies. That you will be providing a good food for the flower horns by giving them mollies.
Okay. So the other question is, how pH change in water is capable of changing gender in swordtail fish? And what are the factors that make the changes in the gender?
See, when there is a fertilization occurring, the embryo has the capability to adapt itself to the particular environment. So when the male clutches the sperms into the female body. This particular environment, which has a lower pH, it will start hindering the development of embryos in such a manner that the later the embryo develops, the possibility of the females are higher. The quicker it develops, the possibility of males are higher. So this particular pH will act or work on the development of embryo. So that is the problem when you have a selective breeding or the sex reversal happening in the swatting.
Okay, sir. If we give variety of food, does the color of fishes change?
Definitely, yes. When we are talking about live food, yes, live food has the capability of giving the original colors to the fishes. But now, since this industry has become an ornamental industry rather than an aquarius industry, yes, people are more important about the color. So there are many hormone-fed feeds which are developed based on plant pigments. So feeds are being incorporated with astaxanthins, carrageenans to improve the pigmentation levels in the fishes also. So definitely there are feeds which will improve the fish color.
Okay, sir. So which type of tank is better for breeding koi carps?
Koi carps, I usually suggest a garden pool. It is not at all, you don't worry about tanks. You go in for a large cement tanks, which are very huge, like in garden pools or garden ponds, because these koi fishes will grow up almost up to 2 feet in length when they are in under maturity. So definitely you will not be able to hold them in your smaller aquariums. It is always preferable to have larger tanks.
Okay, so the next question is, like swat tail, is there any other technique to get more guppy male than female?
We have tried, in fact. pH again works there. Like in swat tail, when you alter the pH of the water, definitely there are chances of getting a highly colored males and a limited number of females. Because in guppy, males are highly sought after than the females. Females are mainly used only in the sake of breeding. For ornamental purpose, it is only the males which is preferred.
The next question is a bit tricky. How we define barb numbers, which type size of fishes coming under barb? Because Systemus sarana also like size like other minor carps, tinfoil barbs, also 25 centimeters. How do we define barbs based on scientifically?
No, the definition of barbs based scientifically is only based on the family. They all come under one particular family, Cyprinidae. But as I told you earlier in the presentation itself, one exception is your tinfoil barb, which is completely out of the size schedule. But all the other characteristics, if you look into the dorsal fin position, the abdominal body, the caudal fin, the anal fin, the mouth size, the mouth presentation. So these are the things where you identify a fish in a family. It is not only based on the size. Sizes, okay. Even keep an example, goldfishes and carps are of same family, but they are completely in different sizes. So that is where comes in the barbs. So barbs as a fish, it has been identified based on many other characteristics rather than the body size alone.
Okay, sir. So one person has asked a question which he is facing in his aquarium. He had two male fishes, male goldfishes, which started chasing the female. Therefore, he had isolated the two males and one female. So even after a long period, they did not breed in dim light. So what he tried was he had tried hand breeding as well. No, and fine, still he has failed. So he wants to know whether the goldfishes, they breed or not.
See, definitely we have bred many goldfishes, even in community tanks. The problem is you should maintain a proper sex ratio. See, you told that you had maintained two males and one female.
Yeah.
Instead, you can go in, you can try in for two males and four females.
Okay.
Sex ratio matters here when you're going in for breeding, because there might sometimes be these kinds of aggression when you don't get a proper mate. So when you're going in for best mates, when you go in for a better sex ratio, then definitely there's a possibility of your goldfish breeding in your tanks.
So the other question is, does lighting in an aquarium affect the breeding of fishes?
Definitely, yes. See, highly littered aquarium, usually these fishes are sensitive. They don't prefer highly lit aquarium to breed or place their young ones. The problem is they would be afraid of any predator coming and eating their young ones or the eggs. If it is highly lit, that will be easily visible. So that is the reason these fishes, they prefer dimly lit aquarium or a aquarium with many hiding places so that they can safeguard their egg ones till they hatch out and come out as an young adult. So definitely lighting is one issue in breeding.
Another question is, some ornamental fishes are cannibalistic in nature. So how can we identify these types of fishes?
See, as I told you earlier, cichlid, the family variety, the family of cichlids, they are definitely, they'll eat whatever comes in their way, which if they suit their mouth. So when you're going in for a community tank, it is better to avoid cichlid fishes and go in for a more peaceful fishes like the tetras, barbs, and the other live bearers. Even in live bearers, if you find a swatail, they will eat the larvae of guppies. I mean, the young ones of guppies easily. So you should be very clear whether you're going to hold fishes just for keeping them as pet or if you're going to breed them. If you're going to breed them, it is always to have individual species aquarium. If you're having guppies, you're going right to breed guppy, have guppy alone. If you're going to breed a molly or a swatail, keep them alone in breeding tanks. If in community tanks, there will definitely be a possibility of, because these are all wild organisms. They can eat anything which comes and which suits their mouth. They won't know whether it is going to be a larvae of the other fish or a fin of the other fish. So that is the problem with these fishes.
So that takes us to the next question, which is a person is asking whether, which is the expensive fish?
It all depends. See, I would categorize expensive in the terms of the beauty. But unfortunately, now we have got certain vastu issues induced into our aquarium industry, where there is a fish called as arowana. This particular arowana is a native of Amazon. Very, very poor fish. It was in the wild of Amazon. It was a very hard hunting fish. I don't know how it got into our this system, but I'm not against it, but that fish is almost sold to a tune of 2 lakhs to 3 lakhs based on the color. The chili red golden arowana can be sold even up to 3 to 4 lakhs. Very amusing, in fact.
Okay.
But apart from it, most of the Tanganyika lake cichlids, all the Malawi lake cichlids, they are quite expensive. One fish would cost you somewhere around 3,000 to 4,000 rupees. So that is the expensive I'm talking about. But this particular arowana is completely out of the league.
Sir, what type of food can be used to increase the production of pigments?
Yeah, live feeds are mostly advisable. Most live feeds like brine shrimp or your mosquito larvae, these kinds of food will definitely improve the color. But if you need a brighter color, for example, in goldfish, if you give prepared feed, the color induces more when compared to your live food. So it depends on species also. A brightly colored for male guppies, when you start giving them with minute small flakes, which is being incorporated with carrageenan or astaxanthin or plant pigments, you get a good color when compared to your live feeds.
Sir, maybe your talk has inspired many to start up with the aquarium. A participant is asking that they want to start with the aquarium in their house. So what would be the first fish that they should be buying?
First thing, you don't buy a fish. Okay. That is my advice. At least for a week or so, get your tank, put the substrate, keep the proper filter, set up the lighting, place 2-3 small plants and circulate it at least for a week or so. If you find the plants to grow, start growing in 1 week, then you go in for a guppy. Maybe 2-3 guppies you can start up with. Wait for one more week again. So it is not like you just bring it in, put all the fishes together, enjoy it, again kill the fishes. No, you put guppies, you wait for some more time. Once the guppies survive in a tank for at least a week, then you can start introducing whatever fish you like. The community aquarium, you can go in for tetras, mollies, or whatever fish you would prefer.
Okay, sir. So there are many comments stating that it is a composed and very informative session. And one another question is, how are using decorative materials harboring artificial colors in aquarium, whether they can have any harmful effects on exotic fishes?
Yeah, definitely they have. See, that is what usually when I do my setup and maintenance, because I do my own for my clients. So what I do is I don't prefer artificial settings. There are certain cases where people want to have artificial settings. When you get an artificial setting, what I do is first wash it thoroughly in water, soak it for at least a week, remove all the leaching which comes out of the artificial setting, then you keep it inside. So most of the colors will not come out. So there'll be definitely colors will be there in your artificial, whatever hiding places or pots or fishes or ships. There are many kinds of artificial toys have come up. Before putting it in an aquarium, make sure you soak it for at least 2 to 3 days in the water, wash it thoroughly, then you can have it in your aquarium. It did not have more effect on your fishes.
Do angelfish exhibit sexual dimorphism, sir?
Yes, definitely yes. That's what I told you. Initial stages of identifying a male and female in an angelfish, it's quite difficult. But once they start pairing, you can easily differentiate between a male and a female. Like any other fishes, the females are much rounded and they have a bigger belly than compared to the males are much slender. They have long fins. And one more thing is the males develop the reproductive spots on their foreheads. They'll develop a small hump when you see during the mating period.
Sir, Oranda's red carps, lionfish cannot be tank mates with barbs, especially tiger barb mollies.
Definitely no. Tiger barbs are notorious fin nippers.
Okay.
These tiger barbs will definitely nip the skin, the fins of the goldfish. So it is always not advisable to have them with tiger barbs.
There are another question is how to successfully culture marine ornamental fish.
It is quite a good question because I should have definitely talked about it, but that will become another session for me to talk about. See, marine fishes, the problem is, as I told you earlier in the first slide, if you remember, the water quality parameter. Because in the marine environment, the parameters are continuously changing with changes in time. But unfortunately for freshwater, the water quality parameters, they remain stable for a longer period. But marine fish, the water quality parameters maintained itself is quite a bit difficult task. They need high protein diet when compared to the freshwater ones. When you give them high protein diet, the water quality parameters can be easily deteriorated. So you should have specialized equipment for removing the proteins like protein skimmers. So that is another step. So you should have lighting and photo periods, which is, it should almost exceed up to 12 lux. For planted aquariums, we can go up to 8 to 9 lux. But for marine aquariums, you should have a different set of filtration system, which will continuously keep filtering when compared to the fresh ones. And one more problem is, they are very, very aggressive fishes when compared to the freshwater. So that is the problem we are facing when we are going in for breeding. Even though the clown fishes, the damsels, few angels and few butterflies have been successfully bred, the other beautiful varieties are yet to be explored. So these are the reasons. The main first thing is the water quality parameters. They live in a condition where the water exhibits very, very high activity each and every time. The waves, the tides, the temperature, the rainfall, the precipitation, the sunlight, the salinity. So it is quite difficult in maintaining them. That is the reason we are not getting into much of this freshwater marine breeding.
Sir,
what people are doing right now.
Yeah. Is angelfish monogamous?
Definitely, yes. That's what I told you there also in the slide. Once a mated pair is set, they won't leave them until a complete cycle is done. At least one of the mating pair, it should be either dead or we should remove it. Otherwise, they will remain same for a very long period.
Sir, repeated questions from the same person. How do we define barbs if tinfoil and system is like large fish coming under barbs? Is there any defined term for barb? He is repeatedly making
I told you earlier, you have a specific set of identification points defined by FAO.
Okay.
If you get an FAO field guide for identification, they have defined each and every fish based on the number of dorsal fin, the size of the dorsal fin, the size of the tail fin, the caudal fin, the anal fin, the size of the operculum, the protuberance of the mouth size. So these are the characteristics which define a particular fish of a particular family, not the sizes. Again.
Sir, people are asking about the tank cleaner fish because you didn't mention them.
Tank cleaner, again, it is a fish which you can have it with any other fish in an aquarium. The only thing is, it will eat more and it will grow more. Okay. It will grow to a size of, if you look into a size of a tank cleaner in a very, very good, healthy planted aquarium, it will be like a crocodile. It will definitely not look good to your eye. So that is the reason I don't recommend tank cleaners for smaller aquariums or in a planted aquarium. In a community aquarium, when you're having bigger fishes like the Oscars, firemouth cichlids, tinfoil barbs, you can definitely go in for a tank cleaner.
Sir, how to take good care of fishes as brooders?
Brooders, the first thing I told you was a good food. You give them with good quality live food, definitely these brooders will live happily with you for many years. They'll continuously start brooding in different intervals. Good water quality parameters, maintaining 27 to 28 degrees in temperature, pH of 7 to 8, and you give them good food with good circulation, little amount of circulation, dim littered, definitely brooders will be happy.
Okay, sir. How do we avoid cannibalism in goldfish?
Goldfishes are not usually cannibalistic. Goldfishes are particularly, they prefer vegetative for their food. Only when they are breeding, when they have young ones, sometimes what they do is, if they find the young ones to be threatened or the eggs to be threatened, they just swallow the eggs. So that is the problem they have. It is not that they are cannibalistic. So they just swallow the egg, frightened from the threats around them. Threats around them, in fact.
Okay. So which circumstances is better for beta breeding, cement tanks or glass tanks?
Cement tanks I would prefer.
Okay. And how do we boost immune system of a fish in sudden environmental changes?
See, immune system, it all depends on the food you give. So there is no specific vaccine or any tablets you're going to give for immune system boosted. As I told you, there are certain foods which have plant pigments in them, like carrageenan and astaxanthin, that can be given. Certain fishes, they will easily go in for seaweed meal. If you have a dried seaweed, if you give them, this seaweed will contain all the definitive immune boosters, the pigments, whatever you require for a good, healthy fish.
Sir, we also have some questions from the YouTube.
Okay.
Is there any reference that help to find endangered species?
It is IUCN Red List. You go and just Google IUCN Red List, you can definitely find all the species which are listed under the International Union for Conservation of Nature and Natural Resources. So this is a book, Red Data book, which they give, which will have all the list of species which are endangered, critically endangered and extinct.
And why in swordtail male reverse sex into female when there is a pH of more than 7, as female convert to male is rare?
No, this I'll have to be a little bit clear, because I told you when they are in young ones, the egg stage, the sex reversal might take place. But when you go in for an adult, when there is a possibility of a group with no active male members, these females, like your clownfishes in marine environment, this particular swordtail, a female will have a tendency to change into a male to continue breeding. Because if there are no males in the particular group, definitely the offsprings will not arise. So to increase their possibility of generation, this particular instinct of the female will convert itself into a male, because these fishes will have hermaphrodite behavior. They will have both the sexes inside the body in favorable condition, or when they need to be converted, they will utilize this as a tool for reproduction.
So another question is whether artificial insemination can be used.
Definitely it can be used in bigger fishes. Smaller fishes also they have tried.
Yes.
Goldfishes, carps, even in tinfoil barbs, oscars, you can easily milt the sperm. There is a process called as milting. Usually in aquaculture of food fishes, we do this. Even in aquarium fishes, in good size fishes, in goldfish or carps, you can easily milt the sperms and you can fertilize with the eggs of the female.
Sir, is there something as an immune booster if there is a sudden environmental change?
No, nothing. So the only booster I would suggest is immediate water exchange. This will almost boost the complete system naturally. You need not go in for any medication or nothing. If you find any problem in an aquarium, whatever it may be, the first step you will have to take is exchange 25% to 30% of water immediately, put it with fresh water. That will almost bring down 50% of the problems which you are going to face.
Okay, sir. So I think with that, we have a lot of questions that need to be answered, sir. But due to shortage of time, I think we can end it here. And yeah. The participants, they can contact the speaker for more clarity on questions can be addressed to sir, and he'll be happy to answer all.
I'll be very happy to answer to all your questions. You can directly call me or mail me. I would definitely be pleased to answer all the questions.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. Thank you for the wonderful session. And thank you, participants, for joining us today. So please do join us tomorrow for another session with Dr. K. Mahesh Kumar, who will be talking on the construction and setup of aquarium tanks.
Thank you once again. Thank you all the participants for patiently listening to my lecture. Thank you again.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. Bye-bye.